Good afternoon, everybody. It is my pleasure to welcome you to this therapeutic update that we hold for the first time in 2021. So we have, this is a therapeutic update actually that we planned to hold last year, but because of the second wave of COVID, we had to postpone it. And then we thought, without further postponing, we will hold it, according to the social norms and with online Zoom participation of the wide audience. So it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Gunendrika Kasturiratna. She is the senior consultant neurologist at the National Hospital of Sri Lanka. Rheumatologist, yes. Consultant rheumatologist at the National Hospital of Sri Lanka. And she will be talking about therapeutic update on vasculitis. Over to you, Gunendrika. Thank you.
Good afternoon, and thank you very much, Professor Priyadarshini, for giving me this chance to talk on this topic. So, therapeutic update on management of vasculitis. My lecture will be under the following subheadings: introduction. Vasculitis is inflammation of the blood vessels. So in this picture, you can see the normal artery is having a smooth and regular lumen. With inflammation, there will be edema and narrowing of the vessel lumen. Later, there may be complete occlusion even. This occlusion may be due to the inflammation and edema, plus there may be blood clot formation as well. Later, with resolution, the walls will be very thin and there will be stenosis and aneurysm formation. Inside those aneurysms, there may be a blood clot formation also as a result. So vasculitis due to inflammation of blood vessels will result in thickening of the walls, stenosis, occlusion at tissue level, ischemia, gangrene or bleeding, and aneurysm formation as well. Vasculitis may affect vessels of any size, vessels of any organ system. The disease severity is variable from mild disease to life-threatening conditions. The clinical presentation depends on the organs or tissues involved. And the management decisions may be critical due to the diagnostic dilemmas. Etiology, there is no cause identified. We can generally see that there are idiopathic conditions and there are some vasculitis occurring secondary to other disease conditions. Infections may trigger the onset and relapse, but it is not identified or confirmed as a etiology so far. The primary causes of vasculitis, we have identified those ANCA-associated vasculitis, giant cell arteritis, Takayasu arteritis, polyarteritis nodosa, leukocytoclastic vasculitis, which is confined to the skin, and Kawasaki disease. There are other vasculitis conditions secondary to infection, for example, infective endocarditis, hepatitis B viral infection, syphilis are examples. Many connective tissue diseases will be affected, associated with vasculitis, mainly SLE, inflammatory myositis, systemic sclerosis, mixed connective tissue disease, and Behçet's disease are important. And chronic rheumatoid arthritis also can be associated with secondary vasculitis. Conditions like cryoglobulinemia, some tumors, leukemias or lymphomas, and some drugs can be the primary cause for secondary vasculitis. Pathophysiology also still remain poorly understood. The role of the immune response in the body in vascular injury varies in each disease. However, there are three possible mechanisms identified for vascular damage: antibody mediated, immune complex mediated, and T cell response mediated. Examples for antibody mediated vasculitis are the ANCA associated vasculitis. There are three varieties. Eosinophilic granulomatous polyangiitis, granulomatous polyangiitis, and microscopic polyangiitis. Henoxcholin purpura, cutaneous vasculitis, the drug-induced vasculitis, the hepatitis B-associated vasculitis, lupus vasculitis, and vasculitic Behçet's are due to immune complex-mediated mechanisms. Takayasu arteritis and giantella arteritis, which are large vessel arteritis, is due to T-cell response-mediated mechanisms. Part in the ANCA-associated vasculitis also have been identified due to T-cell mediated mechanisms. So how do we classify? There have been several classifications which have been updated, and we have the latest 2012 revised Chapel Hill Consensus Conference classification. This is just a nosology. This is not for diagnosis. So it is not a, this is not a diagnostic criteria. The basic primary and secondary causes are there depending on the causes of onset. In 1990, the American College of Rheumatology presented a classification based on the clinical features of primary vasculitis. But both clinicians and the researchers were having many issues with this classification. So it was updated in 1994 by the Chapel Hill Consensus Conference. It was further classified depending on the vessel wall size plus some more characteristics. Therefore, this classification is with further subdivisions. So the according to the vessel lumen, examples are Takayasu and Giantcell arteritis. The examples for medium vessel vasculitis are polyarteritis nodosa and the Kawasaki disease. Multiple varieties of small vessel vasculitis are there, ANCA-associated vasculitis, and those immune complex small vessel vasculitis. The further divisions are, they have included Behçet's disease in the variable vessel vasculitis category because they have seen there are both, I mean, it's not only small vessel, large or medium vessels also sometimes affected in Behçet disease. And cutaneous leukocytoclastic angiitis, that is a single organ vasculitis, so confined to the skin. There are other varieties of cutaneous vasculitis described here. And vasculitis associated with other systemic diseases like lupus vasculitis, rheumatoid vasculitis, sarcoid, and few others have been classified separately. And some vasculitis conditions are associated with probable etiology. For example, hepatitis C associated vasculitis, the cryoglobulinemic vasculitis, hepatitis B virus associated vasculitis, syphilis, drug associated, and cancer associated. So here they have found probable etiologies, therefore they have been classified separately. So this is a more descriptive classification with lot of clinical input. So how do we diagnose? There are diagnostic classification criteria described, but always the clinical diagnosis is the most superior. We can get laboratory findings, histology, and imaging evidence to confirm our diagnosis. So about the clinical features, those patients with vasculitis, before they present with specific features depending on the tissues and organs involved, they will have general symptoms like this. So the duration of this general illness varies. Sometimes it may go for a long duration without a diagnosis. They may have fever, sometimes fever of unknown origin, malaise, fatigue, loss of weight, poor appetite, myalgia, arthralgia. All those non-specific general illness will precede the occurrence of specific symptoms. Specific features will depend on the tissues and the organs involved. Potentially, any organ can be involved in vasculitis. The classic symptoms due to large vessel vasculitis are claudication of limbs. It may be arm or leg. Amaurosis fugax can occur, and hypertension with inequality. Sometimes we read two different blood pressure readings in both arms, left and right arms. And loss of pulses or weak pulse, again with inequality. Sometimes we can't feel the pulse, distal pulse in one arm, but still we can feel the pulse in the other arm. So, and we may be able to listen to breeze in the areas of vasculitic involvement. So you should be aware where to listen for this breeze. So maybe in the neck, over the subclavian arteries, and maybe over the renal arteries. In medium vessel involvement, it's the renal artery which is involved. So there will be renovascular hypertension associated with mononeuritis multiplex, necrotic ulcers, or maybe gangrenous digits. But small vessel vasculitis will present rather early because these small vessels will present with cutaneous lesions like the classic palpable purpura of vasculitis. And due to involvement of the small vessels in the kidney, they will present with hematuria or proteinuria. Lung involvement can occur, and lung hemorrhage can be the presenting feature. Gangrenes are also possible in small vessel vasculitis as well. But there are a lot of overlaps. Large and medium vessel vasculitis may involve small vessels as well. So it's not a hard and fast rule here. This chart is comparing the ANCA-associated vasculitis, the three varieties of ANCA-associated vasculitis with polyarthritis nodosa, because there are a lot of overlaps. So this is a comparison for the clinician to use. The involvement in the sinus or sinus disease is mostly seen in vaginous granulomatosis, but also seen in the choke stress disease as well. Subglottic stenosis has been seen in vaginous granulomatosis. Asthma is a classic feature of choke stress disease. Pulmonary nodules are found mainly in vaginous granulomatosis, but they are possible in other types of ANCA-associated vasculitis as well. In vaginous, we have seen this cavitatory lung disease, but not seen in the other conditions. Alveolar hemorrhage is found in all three ANCA-associated vasculitis, but not in polyarthritis nodosa. Glomerulonephritis will affect the ANCA-associated vasculitis, but not polyarthritis nodosa. In polyarthritis nodosa, what we find is renal artery involvement and hypertension. Neuropathy is common to all categories, but mostly the mononeuritis multiplex is mostly seen in polyarthritis nodosa. Cardiac involvement is also possible in all the four conditions. Histologically, granulomas are found in vaginous and choke stress disease. Eosinophilia is a classic feature in choke stress disease, and the ANCA positivity is there with the ANCA-associated vasculitis, and the typical or classic microaneurysm formation in imaging will be there in polyarthritis nodosa. So this is a comparison of different clinical presentation which can be overlapped. So then skin manifestation of vasculitis. Skin is the largest organ, but it is available for us to see with our naked eye. So those skin manifestations are very useful to come to a differential diagnosis. Most common presentations of several vasculitis syndromes are skin manifestation. So in granulom, this ANCA-associated vasculitis, in different percentages, skin manifestations will be evident. Skin manifestations may be the cutaneous component of a systemic vasculitis, or it may be a skin dominant variant of a systemic vasculitis, or it may be single organ cutaneous vasculitis. And some clues may help to recognize both the size and the size of the vessel and the involved organ system, so that we can come to a differential diagnosis. The palpable purpura is the most familiar typical lesion due to small vessel vasculitis, which appears in the distal limbs. And they are painful, palpable, having burning type pain even at rest. Also, there may be other lesions like non-palpable purpura, pinpoint papules, vesicles, pustules, splinter hemorrhages, urticarial type lesions, shallow ulcers, all are possible in small vessel vasculitis. So these skin lesions will give us a clue to think about our differential diagnosis. In medium-sized vessel vasculitis, the lesions are a bit different. They are subcutaneous nodules, this livedoid skin, large or deeper ulcers than in small vessel vasculitis. There are other lesions like necrotic lesions and digital infarcts as well. This picture, in the first picture, it is a little bit different lesion with purpura, petechiae, vesicles, and small hemorrhages. And the second picture, B, is the confluent lesions of palpable purpura. So these vasculitic lesions, these are of small vessel, cutaneous small vessel vasculitis. So they may be confluent like in the first two pictures, or maybe just a small area involving the extremities of limbs, as you see in the third picture. So you have to be very, have a good clinical suspicion to examine and find those lesions which are important clues for our diagnosis. These are different. So this is typical or classic features seen in polyarthritis nodosa. These are subcutaneous nodules most of the time, and the ulcers we see are necrotic, larger, and deeper. Here, again, these irregular, larger, and deeper ulcers are seen. And you can see the picture of a livedoid pattern in the skin. And there may be digital gangrenes as shown in this picture as well. So with these clinical features, we have our differential diagnosis. And we can get the help of laboratory features to confirm or narrow down our differential diagnosis. Full blood count usually will show a neutrophil leukocytosis, and the inflammatory markers, both ESI and CRP, will be elevated. Autoantibodies, ANCA, rheumatoid factor, antinuclear antibody, and if necessary, full ENA panel can be requested. Cryoglobulin level is also an important investigation to come to a differential diagnosis or to exclude other diagnoses. Screening for hepatitis B and C is important, and we have to screen for other organ involvement as well. Urine full report is a must. If there is evidence of proteinuria, we have to get a quantitative assessment of the proteinuria. We can request for this spot test, urinary protein creatinine ratio, or we have to collect 24-hour urines and measure the protein amount. Liver transaminases and renal functions are also necessary in the preliminary screening for the organ involvement. Histology will confirm definitive diagnosis if we have accessible sites for a biopsy. Most of the skin lesions will give clues if we can get a biopsy, a proper biopsy, and the histology report will guide us for our diagnosis. In temporal arteritis, temporal artery biopsy is also a possible or an accessible site for a biopsy. Sinus biopsy is also useful if we suspect vaginal or choke stress disease. Renal biopsies and lung biopsies are a bit invasive, but will give us clues to come to a diagnosis. Imaging. Especially in large vessel vasculitis and medium vessel vasculitis, we may not have histological diagnosis. So imaging is going to be the confirmatory investigation. Imaging is for two targets. We want to do end organ imaging to evaluate the extent of organ involvement, chest x-rays, CT chest, CT sinus or brain, echocardiogram, and MRI brain. Then comes the vascular imaging to come to a definitive diagnosis. Doppler arterial ultrasound scan can be used to assess the limbs if we suspect, if we have a discrepancy in the pulses and if they have claudication. Initially, a Doppler ultrasound will give us a clue. Conventional angiogram for polyarthritis nodosa is still the best to visualize the typical microaneurysms. CT and MR angiogram, CT and MR venogram, and PET scans are also available for further evaluation. Other tests like ECGs, EEGs, nerve conductions and EMGs, pulmonary function test, bronchoscopy and alveolar lavage. So those are also going to help us to evaluate the extent of organ involvement. Two pictures showing the narrowing of carotid arteries in a patient with Takayasu arteritis in a MR angiogram. And the second picture is showing the microaneurysms in polyarthritis nodosa in a conventional angiography. Right, so now we come to the management. In the management, I will describe it in three steps. This is the standard management described in all the guidelines. Remission induction, remission maintenance, follow-up and monitoring for the disease activity as well as for the side effects of the medications we use. Remission induction is always with high-dose glucocorticoids followed by other immunosuppressants if necessary. The route of administration is decided clinically depending on the severity of the disease and the extent of organ involvement. If there is organ-threatening or life-threatening disease, we select intravenous methylprednisolone. The dose is 500 to 1 milligram, 1 gram. We can continue from 3 to sometimes 6 pulses have been tried. That is that amount of the number of pulses decided depending on the clinical response. Or if it is a milder disease, we can select oral prednisolone, but a high dose, 1 milligram per kilogram, which we have to continue for 1 month. In life-threatening or organ-threatening disease, we combine the IV methylprednisolone with cyclophosphamide. Again, we give it in pulses. Usually, we give six pulses in a duration of 3 to 6 months. We can also use mycophenolate mopital. It's a good drug where we can use for remission induction. And sometimes we have to get the use of biologic drugs like rituximab and tocilizumab as well. And sometimes during this remission induction period, we may have to get the help of adjunctive therapies like plasma exchange and IV immunoglobulins. Especially in conditions with associated with alveolar hemorrhage and rapidly progressing glomerular nephritis, a few cycles of plasma exchange will help to achieve the disease control in a shorter period. Then IV immunoglobulins are also indicated in some situations, especially when there are infections, secondary infections counteracting. Then we have to maintain the achieved remission. Remission maintenance is done with the help of tapering doses of oral prednisolone plus the help of other immunosuppressants like methotrexate, azathioprine, mycophenolate mopital, biologic drugs, rituximab or tocilizumab. So I'm mentioning rituximab and tocilizumab because they are the drugs which have been used in clinical trials and they are the ones which have described in guidelines. So there are target doses described in the guidelines for oral prednisolone to be tapered. This remission maintenance should be continued for a duration like 18 to 25 months after the induction of a sustained remission. This time duration is counted from the onset of a sustained remission, not from the date of remission induction. And also, most of the time, we will have to use prophylaxis for the glucocorticoid-induced osteoporosis. Glucocorticoids, the very useful drug, sometimes it is life-saving, and we always have to use this magic drug in high doses, but we know there's a long side effect profile. There is increased risk of infection, hypertension, hyperglycemia, cataract formation, secondary osteoporosis, avascular necrosis, weight gain, dyslipidemia, mood changes including psychosis, striae and acne, poor wound healing, and growth retardation in children. Therefore, the monitoring recommendations include we should do periodic comprehensive metabolic panel as monitoring and annual DEXA scanning, prophylaxis for pneumocystis jirovecii, especially when combined with other immunosuppressants as well. So I was talking about target doses, how to taper the glucocorticoid during the remission maintenance period. So for an average 60 kilogram person, the trials in key trials of ANCA-associated vasculitis, they give this 10 to 7.5 milligrams a day in a duration of 3 to 5 months. But this is just a guide. It's always done depending on the clinical response. And if all goes well, we can achieve this target dose, but sometimes the patients may relapse. When we try to reduce the dose, they may relapse. And the target doses given in guidelines for large vessel vasculitis, for Takayasu arteritis, we should taper the prednisolone to a dose 15 to 20 milligrams a day by 3 months. And at 1 year, it should be more less than 10 milligrams a day. If the patient is doing well, we can do further tapering after 1 year and sometimes stop the glucocorticoid therapy. For giant cell arteritis, again, 15 to 20 per day in about 2 to 3 months time. Less than 5 milligrams a day after 1 year, further tapering if the targets are achieved. So always, these are just guides. We may have to change these regimes depending on the clinical response. About glucocorticoid-induced osteoporosis, this is the most prevalent form of secondary osteoporosis. Will affect about 30 to 50% of patients who are on long-term glucocorticoids. There's a strong association between glucocorticoid dose and the fracture risk. The greatest risk have been seen during the first 3 to 6 months after starting therapy. The fracture risk of patients on glucocorticoids at a given bone mineral density is higher than that of a non-glucocorticoid treated patient with the same bone mineral density. So it's an independent risk factor for fractures. And the other important thing is fracture risk decreases significantly after stopping the glucocorticoid therapy. So this is why prophylaxis is indicated for patients who are on long-term glucocorticoid therapy. Cyclophosphamide is a very useful drug in life-threatening and organ-threatening conditions to achieve the remission. Again, there's a high side effect profile. Increased risk of infection is there. In addition, bone marrow toxicity, hemorrhagic cystitis, bladder cancer, myelodysplasia, infertility, pulmonary fibrosis, which is rare, and teratogenicity. So we have to monitor them closely, complete blood count once a week. We have to maintain the white cell count above 3,500 per cubic millimeter. We have to do urinary analysis after 1 week and again after 4 weeks after the last infusion, or if they are on oral therapy, then more frequently. We advise patients to take the drug in the morning if they are taking cyclophosphamide orally, because by that way we expect that the patient will not retain urine with the active metabolites of cyclophosphamide for long durations in daytime, because if they take it at night, there will be a prolonged duration having the active metabolites in bladder. And they should drink large amounts of fluid to maintain a dilute urine. Urine cytology should be done every 6 to 12 months to see, to detect early presence of malignant cells. If they have non-glomerular type hematuria, cystoscopy is a must. And also, importantly, we have to offer them effective contraceptive method. Cyclophosphamide is favored as pulse therapy due to the reduced side effect profile, bladder-related complications. It can cause hemorrhagic cystitis in the short term and malignancy in long term. So we advise patients to drink plenty of water. If we are giving this pulse on the previous day, they should drink a lot of water. And we always combine these infusions with Mesna. Mesna binds to the toxic metabolites. Therefore, it will reduce the side effects, bladder side effects. And this can be given even with oral regimens too. Methotrexate, this is a once a week drug due to the side effects, and always combined with folic acid. Again, adverse effects include high risk of infection, hepatotoxicity, acute pneumonitis, bone marrow toxicity, myositis, teratogenicity, and possible lymphoma. Monitoring should include complete blood counts, transaminases, and serum creatinine more frequently during the first month, and then later we can do it every month. Patients should abstain from alcohol. We combine this treatment either folic acid 1 mg daily or folinic acid 5 mg once a week. This folinic acid should be taken 24 hours after the methotrexate dose to avoid interactions with the mechanism of the drug. And again, effective contraception is necessary. Escitalopram is a purine analog interfering with DNA synthesis. It also has a list of adverse effects. Risk of infection is there, and bone marrow toxicity, hepatotoxicity, and possible leukemia, lymphoma. Here, this thiopurine methyl transferase, some people are deficient with this enzyme. So in that condition, it may lead to severe bone marrow toxicity. So ideally, they recommend to check this TPMT activity before starting therapy. Otherwise, we have to monitor the complete blood counts, transaminases, more frequently at the beginning and later every month. Mycophenolate mofetil. Again, we can use this in the remission induction as well as during the remission maintenance period. Adverse effects include increased risk of infection, bone marrow toxicity, teratogenicity, and sometimes people get a lot of GI disturbance. This is a fairly well tolerated drug and is very effective both for remission induction and also to maintain the remission. But we have to monitor with complete blood counts every week for the first month, and then later every 4 weeks. Ideally, pregnancy testing should be done in women of childbearing age. If we are going to initiate this drug, usually we think about the age and whether they have completed the family, and all these things should be taken into consideration before we start these cytotoxic drugs in patients. Always it has to be a discussion between the patient and the doctor. So if they are ready to take the drug and we have to initiate this drug, we have to offer them effective contraception. And biologics for vasculitis. Biologics are targeted immune suppressants, so have shown a lot of impressive results because of this nature of having targets in their immune suppression mechanisms. There are different types of vasculitis responding to different biologics. In the practice is that rituximab is used for ANCA-associated vasculitis, tocilizumab and TNF inhibitors are used in large and medium vessel vasculitis. Rituximab, it's a chimeric monoclonal antibody. This is directed against the cell surface protein CD20 on the B-cell lymphocyte lineage. Rituximab induced killing of CD20 plus cells via multiple mechanisms and also will reduce the circulating pathogenic antibody levels and also the antibody presenting cells. So circulating B cells will remain undetectable for 6 to 12 months after an infusion. This is contraindicated in patients with active hepatitis B because this may induce increased replication of the hepatitis B virus. We have to be cautious with hepatitis C infection also because rituximab will increase the hepatitis C virus expression in hepatocytes. So we must screen the patients for hepatitis B and C infections before we initiate the treatment. And rituximab will cause hypoimmunoglobulinemia. So ideally, serum immunoglobulin levels should be tested prior to each course of rituximab infusions. This is given as an IV infusion. Initially, we give two doses as loading, first dose and the second dose in 2 weeks. And after that, we infuse 6 monthly infusions. This is not inferior to cyclophosphamide for remission induction. And rituximab is preferable to cyclophosphamide when we want to preserve reproductive potential of young patients. It's a good alternative, but sometimes we may have to switch to cyclophosphamide and vice versa when the disease is relapsing and when it is resistant disease. Next is tocilizumab. Tocilizumab is a humanized anti-IL-6 receptor monoclonal antibody. This will block IL-6 signaling. IL-6 is an important mediator, a cytokine in inflammatory process. IL-6 induces antibody production, and IL-6 will activate the Th17 cells. And also IL-6 is the cytokine responsible for inflammation associated anemia or anemia of chronic disorder, especially in inflammation, because IL-6 increases the hepcidin level. Hepcidin is the one which is giving rise to this anemia of inflammation. Therefore, in patients with autoimmune diseases, IL-6 will be helpful to improve the anemia of inflammation as well. Tofacitinib is a novel target therapy. This is given oral. This inhibits the Janus kinase. Janus kinase is a having a role in signal transduction in inflammation. So by blocking this Janus kinase, inflammation is very well controlled in some conditions, but only few case reports are available with good results for vasculitis. It's not appearing in guidelines. Still, we need to have more evidence to start using tofacitinib in patients with vasculitis. So the advantage is that this is given oral. Yes, now how to follow up and monitor. So this disease course may be one of the following. It may come to clinical remission and then sustained remission and glucocorticoid-free remission. But it may be a relapsing disease or it may be a refractory disease for our treatment. So what are we doing in a relapse? Relapse is a recurrence of the active disease. Recurrence of active disease or relapse may be of two types, may be a major relapse or it may be a minor relapse. In a major relapse, we have to consider it as a new onset disease and we escalate the glucocorticoids up to the previous remission induction level. In minor relapse, we have to escalate the glucocorticoid doses up to the last effective dose. So that's why I told at the beginning that tapering glucocorticoids will not be as in the guidelines. It all depends on the nature of the natural course of the disease and the response of the patient. So in relapses, we will have to modify the doses of the adjunctive agents, other immune suppressants. Sometimes we may have to add, combine, or adjust the doses of other immune suppressants as well. Remissions are again described in different levels. Clinical remission is absence of clinical features, and there should be normal inflammatory markers. And in vasculitic types like large vessel and medium sized, new imaging should be as the previous. I mean, there should be absence of new imaging findings as well. We call sustained remission when the remission is persistent clinical remission is persistent for more than 6 months. And here, if we have to call it a sustained remission, the clinical remission should be more than 6 months, and the steroid doses should be less than the targeted doses at 1 year. And if they improve further, we can achieve glucocorticoid-free remission. So they are not on steroids, managed with other immunosuppressants, but those immunosuppressants have to be non-biologic immunosuppressants. Right. Now, about pregnancy and vasculitis. So most of the vasculitis disease onset is more in females and in the childbearing age. But we have very poor data because of the low incidence. Patients with vasculitis, they have a low incidence of pregnancies. Effective contraception should be provided while they are on cytotoxic or teratogenic drugs. And pregnancy should be planned. It should happen when the disease is in remission. And if they relapse during pregnancy, we have to treat adequately. Sometimes we may need to treat aggressively because the active disease can be more detrimental to the fetus than the drugs we use here. And the other problem is the risk of thromboembolic events are increased in pregnancy if they flare. About the drugs we use during pregnancy and lactation, glucocorticoids, no side effects have been reported even with high doses in the baby, but and the amount secreted in breast milk is fairly low, but we should try to use the lowest possible doses of cortisone, hydroxycortisone or prednisone, but not dexamethasone. And the other important thing is we should give stress doses of steroids during labor. If the mother has been on any dose of glucocorticoids for the last 3 weeks before the delivery. Again, severe flares of vasculitis will be more harmful than the high dose of glucocorticoids, but the baby should be monitored for adrenal insufficiency after birth, depending on the duration of the glucocorticoid therapy in the mother. Cyclophosphamide is teratogenic, so it's not indicated during pregnancy and lactation. Azathioprine is safe to continue during pregnancy and lactation. Methotrexate and mycophenolate mofetil both are teratogenic, so not recommended in pregnancy and lactation. Rituximab, we have insufficient data, so advised better to avoid. But in critical situations with life-threatening or organ-threatening conditions, we can use it with caution prior to the conception or during the first trimester, and not recommended in during lactation. Tocilizumab, again, has we have insufficient data, so better avoided and not recommended during lactation. So if they have been on those immunosuppressants which are cytotoxic and teratogenic, how can they plan for their pregnancy? So in a disease remission, we have to omit methotrexate for at least three months in female. It's generally safe in men. Mycophenolate mofetil, again, the woman should be off the drug for a period like 3 to 6 months. Males also better to be off the drug for 3 months, but in men there is no evidence of teratogenicity. Cyclophosphamide, we have to omit the drug and ask the female to wait for 1 year. For males, 4 months will be enough. Rituximab, 1 year after the last infusion, women can attempt conception. No firm evidence of harm among men, so we have inadequate evidence. Tocilizumab for females, after 3 months, they can consider pregnancy. No evidence of harm in males, again, with tocilizumab as well. So, and lastly, about antiplatelet or anticoagulation therapy in vasculitis. Antiplatelet or anticoagulation therapy is not indicated routinely unless there are special situations like coronary artery disease, strokes, or high risk of coronary vascular disease, cardiovascular disease in the background. Now, in summary, vasculitis can be clinical emergency with multiple organ involvement. Clinical suspicion is of utmost importance in the diagnosis. Immunosuppressive and cytotoxic agents are used to manage most of the disease conditions. So further research is needed to understand these diseases and to discover more efficacious yet less toxic therapeutic options. And careful therapeutic decision making and driving the need for safer and more effective therapeutic options is the need. The list of references. Thank you.
That is via Zoom, and then another number via Facebook as well, although we don't have much in the audience. So I have actually asked for any questions. If you have, you can send it via chat forum so that we can ask Gunendrika on any questions that you may have on the presentation given. Can I just ask until we get any questions? Now, you said the steroid dose,
yes,
we are using this alone. Standard, we use it at 1 milligram per kg. So that amounts to, large dose of steroid. And I think probably the dose of steroid is not based on any evidence. It's just used at 1 milligram. So with the increased osteoporosis, because it comes to about 60 milligrams for a 60 kg person.
And lowest possible dose is the correct answer. This is available in the guidelines, but some people are having other risk factors like metabolic syndromes, diabetes, hypertension, and but if the condition is organ threatening, life threatening, we have a tendency to go for intravenous because it is given in pulses rather than continuing the high dose for 1 month or a long duration. And as soon as possible, we are planning to taper the steroid dose with addition of other immunosuppressants from the beginning. And with the availability of biologics, again, we have been able to cut down these high dose steroids sooner than before, which is a very good benefit for the patient.
Yes, I think that's quite important, isn't it? Because people tend to use this 1 milligram per kg and therefore quite high.
Yeah, we usually start that dose, but most of the time before 1 month, in 2 weeks' time, we cut down by 2.5, like that. As much as possible, we try to cut down the dose as soon as possible. But similarly, premature withdrawal of steroids will give rise to flares, which is again not a good thing for the long-term survival of the patient.
And perhaps, giving the pulse steroids in the situation where a patient,
yes,
requires high doses probably would lead to less.
Yes, kind of yes, yes.
Doesn't seem to be any further questions. Have you been treating these patients with biologics, or is the experience that you have on the use of biologics for patients with vasculitis?
Yes, actually, when to use the biologic and which drug to use is very, very clinical. Different clinicians will think differently. I also have the experience because I have had young patients with organ involvement like renal, lung, and sometimes cerebral involvement. So rituximab has been very promising. There was a severe lung involvement in one of the patients with granulomatous polyangiitis. She suddenly presented while she was in remission with azathioprine and tapering doses of prednisolone, but suddenly presented with severe nodules and cavitation of the lung. And so she's still unmarried. And when I discussed with her and her parents, she never thought of cyclophosphamide, accepting cyclophosphamide. So rituximab was our choice. And after four doses, now the lung has almost all recovered. The nodules have gone down. And now she's being managed with mycophenolate-mofetil as the remission maintenance therapy. You can use continue the rituximab or biologic as well for maintenance, but depending on the clinical response, we decide which drug to be used for remission maintenance as well. And again, there's another one with two people with Takayasu arthritis, it's resistant disease. Again, they are on tocilizumab with good results.
Any questions from the audience? Dr. Lama, I think another very important problem that patients face is monitoring, because I think there are no markers. So what is it that you use?
Yeah,
monitoring?
Actually, yeah. It's only autoantibodies available, the ANCA antibodies, but the other vasculitides, they don't have immune markers. And we can't go by the inflammatory markers as well, because sometimes at the time of diagnosis also they have moderately high inflammatory markers. So it's always clinical features that we have to count, rely on, especially in large vessel vasculitis like Takayasu. It's very difficult to go by the laboratory features. It's all clinical criteria, new onset of colocation, new onset of any difference in the blood pressure, pulse. Those are the things we consider. And sometimes we have to repeat imaging as well to find out whether the patient is relapsing or not. New emergence of imaging findings is also an indication of a relapse. And small vessel vasculitis, they depend on the presentation. So in small vessel, we can monitor the renal and other organ functioning, urine reports and protein assessment. So these things are useful in other types of vasculitis. So it's mainly clinical.
So would you recommend regular imaging, like in Takayasu, any regular imaging in a person who is otherwise well controlled and non-maintenance therapy?
No. Routine imaging is not recommended, but it depends on the new emergence of symptoms. But we can use those non-invasive imaging like Doppler arterial scanning for the limbs, and where possible, even for renal arteries, we can try Doppler arterial scan. So before going into invasive, or we have to expose them for radiation if we are doing CT and angiograms and things. So therefore, we try to minimize the harm for the patient as well. If really indicated, we have to repeat the imaging as well.
Right. Okay. I think we don't seem to be having any further questions from the audience. So in the absence of any further questions, let me thank Dr. Gunendika Kasturiratnam for the lecture. We are covering all aspects. And on behalf of the SLMA, I thank you and like to present you, this certificate of
thank you.